seasons, but they are new every morning. Let us worship him because he is our God and we are the sheep of his pasture. Let us begin to worship him because he's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Let us extol him. Let us exalt him. Let us lift him high above all other. Daddy, we worship you. Daddy, we exalt you because you are God. Because you are our God. And you continue to be our God. Daddy, we thank you for your faithfulness. From Sunday that we departed from this mountain, you watch over us and you brought us back this evening by your grace and by your mercy. Daddy, we ascribe greatness, majesty, excellency, dominion, and power unto you. Daddy, we say you are God. You are not man. Glory be to your name. As we declare him as our God. Yes. For this God is our God. And he our God. Even unto the end. Regardless. No matter what. We will hold on to him. And we know that he will not let loose of us. Because he said he will take care of us to eternity. He said he has loved us with eternal love. He said his mercy for us is eternal. Let us give him praise. Let us worship him. Because he is God. For this God is a God. Forever and ever, he will be our God. From now, even on to the end.
Is our God. I pray that the Lord will stir up an expectation in you today, that you will not go back up the same way you came. Even as before our pastor come and speak to us, I want us to say a short prayer that, Lord, today I will not go back home the same way. Lord, today I will not go back home the same way. Lord, today will be my day of visitation. Lord, today will be my day of visitation. Lord, today will be my day of solution. Lord, today will be my day of manifestation. Lord, today will be my day of fulfillment. Father, Lord God Almighty, we thank you. Father, we thank you. We come against every spirit of distraction. We come against everything that will deny you of that which the Lord has prepared for you. Thank you, everlasting Father. Thank you, King of Kings. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen. Can we just celebrate our pastor, Pastor Simon, as he gave us the word?
Hallelujah, church. Yeah, please give me one moment as I change this. I hope it's gone. Are you happy today, church?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Nobody's answering. Are you sure, church?
Yes. Yes, we're happy.
Everybody say with me, the joy of the Lord,
the joy of the Lord
is my strength.
Is my strength.
Let's say it again. The joy
of the Lord,
is
my strength.
What is your strength, church?
The joy of the Lord.
What is your strength, church?
The joy of the Lord.
Now, when we bask in the joy of the Lord, there is nothing the devil can do that can rubbish us. We are just in the spirit of the joy. The joy of the Lord is so overflowing, so all-engulfing. There is no force of hell that can prevent or rival or reduce or traduce that joy. The joy of the Lord is your strength.
Amen.
We are back today to our studies in Exodus. How many of you noticed that for 4 weeks now, we have been in chapter 3? And we have not even gone past what chapter?
Verse.
What verse?
Verse 3.
Verse 5. In fact, we are still in the threshold of verse 5. I am so grateful to the Lord because He chooses His word. And I have no doubt that what God started to instruct us in the house of prayer has been very, very timely. Has been very, very timely. So today we are back to Exodus. Everybody say, God has a plan. Now, if you are sure, say it louder. God has a plan. Now, I am going to read the scripture and then we will jump into the Bible study for today. Thank you, Pastor Mike. Thank you, Sister Becky. Thank you, choir, for that very, very beautiful preparation. Now, from verse 1. Are you there, people of God?
Yes.
Are you there, people of God?
Yes.
Do we have different versions in the house today? How many of you are with King James Version? If you are in King, those are the Gregorian brethren. I'm not. We have some Gregorian brethren here. In the days of D and thou and doest and comest, from whence comest thou? I lift up my eyes to the east, from whence comest my help? You need to position nest yourself in order to understand that, those words. But there are simpler versions, aren't they? There are simpler versions. Now, if you read the Living Bible, it's so down to earth and simple. I love that. And if you now read, there are some latest versions of scripture. Now, the challenge I'm quickly putting to us, church, is buy the truth. Don't sell it. Buy the truth. Make sure you are all out. At a point, my wife was very wary of me at the beginning of our marriage, at the beginning of our journey. Because I have not even said what I want to say. But if I give the microphone to her now, she will tell you exactly what I have in mind to say. Every travel, everywhere we go, what am I looking for?
Books and Bible.
Books and Bible. Is it only books? One day she said, is it only books we are going to be buying with anything? God? There was a day I went for a revival service in Lagos, and they just handed me an envelope for the honorarium. And as I opened it, I counted it, and I took out the tithe immediately, and I gave it to her. I said, this is the tithe. Put it in your inner purse. And I took the rest, and I bought books and Bible, and we had nothing more. She said, now you see now, is it only books we'll be buying? I said, don't worry. The Bible said, buy the truth and sell it, Lord. You know, you don't need gudem. If you don't want to be crude, you don't need gudem. If you don't want to be exhausted, you don't need exhaustive concordance. I'm not saying those are not good. I have those. But what am I trying to say? The scripture interprets itself. Go and buy as many versions of the Bible. Some of us are blessed because even on our phones, on your Android, on your iPhones, you can download as many versions of the Bible. Don't read one version. I don't read one version. When I want to do a proper study of the Word of God, what I do is, when I read King James Version, and I read New International Version, and I read Today's English Bible, and I read the Amplified Version, and I read the New Century Version, and I read the Jerusalem Version, and I read all those versions, you will see naturally the wealth, the riches, the simplicity of that scripture will jump at you. The clarity of that scripture will just come. So natural, you are not struggling to understand. There will be no doubt as to what this scripture is saying by the time you read it from the understanding of different biblical interpreters. And do you know that these versions are results and functions of different categories of effort that scholars, Bible students, and people have taken their time to study the original work with which the Word of God comes down to us, and they have provided in their own existential understanding and language what those scripture means. So by the time you read it from the point of view of the Today's English Version, also known as Good News Bible, or you read it from the New English Version, or the Easy to Read Bible, and so on and so forth, the scripture comes alive to you. So that's what we're going to do today. So we have the KJV in the house, and then we have the New Living Bible in the house. What other version do we have?
NLT.
New Living Translation. NLT. Yeah, it's actually a little bit different from the Living Bible. TLB. TLB and NLT, they are not the same thing. They are different. Now, so if you have NLT, what do you have?
NLT
is good. That's the Living Translation. Yeah. New Living Translation. New Living Translation is different from the Living Bible. Then, what other version do we have?
Old Man Christian Standard Bible Version.
That's another good one. Which one do you have? New American Standard Bible Version is very, very similar and close to the New King James Version. The New King James Version is different from the King James Version. So now, that's okay. Now, we will jump in there, and I am going to read from King James Version. Oh yeah, you have contemporary. God bless you. We are so rich in the house today. God bless all of us. Now, let me read from the King James Version, and then I'm going to ask somebody to jump in and read. What's your own version? Igbo version. Amplified. Don't read the whole lot of them. What version? Give me one version.
NET.
New English Translation. New English Translation and TLB. They are about the same thing. Find another one. You have New Century? Century?
New International Reader's Version.
New International Reader's Version. I can't remember how that one sounds. But, okay, we will have you read that. Let's go. People of God, are you ready?
Yes.
Now, now, hold on 1 minute. Hold on 1 minute. Hold on 1 minute. I didn't have King James, but I want to read King James. So that people will not think I'm against King James because of the way I spoke. So I want to deliberately read King James. Are you ready, church? Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law. Let there be calmness in the house. God bless you. The priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the back side of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush, and he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. Now, somebody read verse 2 for me. New English Translation. Please jump in there. I will read verse 2. Verse number 2, New English, NET. Okay, let's read your own translation. I need you to be prompt to save time.
The angel of the Lord appeared to him.
The angel of the Lord appeared to him.
In a flame of fire within the bush.
In a flame of fire within the bush.
He looked.
He looked.
The bush was ablaze with fire, but it was not being consumed.
Where is that flame? Amen.
Amen.
Just turn down the volume of this microphone a little. Number 13, turn it down a little, just a little. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. God bless you. Now, do you see the beauty of that translation? What the King James called in the midst of a bush. The New Living Translation call it what?
Flame of fire.
No. The flame of fire is constant. Turn it down a little. The midst of the bush, the New Living Translation call it in the middle. In the middle. Do you notice that? That means betwixt. Now, please read verse 2 for me.
There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing fire from the middle of a bush. Moses stirred in amazement. Though the bush was engulfed in flames, it didn't burn up.
Now, I want all of us to please pay very close attention to what this verse 2 is doing, what the authors are trying to do with this verse 2. I need you to pay attention. Now, what King James call flame of fire, NLT called flame of fire,
NLT, blazing fire.
That one calls it blazing fire. And then what King James call mist of a bush, that this one call between a bush, the NLT call it what?
From the middle
of the bush. Now, there is something God wants to help us achieve in this verse 2 today. And the attention that the Holy Spirit wants us to pay to this, to today's Bible study is, why ask why? When fire. Ask what are you talking? Why ask why? When fire burns in my life, I will ask why, of course. Why? Why is it me? Why? Why is this happening to me? Why? The question why is one of the most asked question. The particle why in any question is more populous than piece of bread in a meal. It's more populous in all the world. The question why in every moment in the whole world, Sentinel survey reveals that among all questions that people ask out of 10, the question why takes 8. Many times we are not concerned about how. Many times we are not concerned about what. Many times, even when is in view, the magnitude of the event, the intensity of situation beclouds our consciousness of when to make us ask the question why. And by the time we are done today with today's Bible study, it will be clear to us what God was doing, why the fire burns. What God was doing, why the fire burns. So the reason for this fire is all that matters, not the imageries or the scenario. God is not a cinematographer. He's not a dramatist. When there is a drama, every drama of the Word of God is an unfolding episode of a true life of somebody. Every drama of the Word of God is a revelation or a foreshadow of our situation today. And God is directly applying this scripture to our life. Now, why do you ask why in the midst of the fire? Why ask why? So now, we have been able to see that whether in your own consciousness you see yourself passing in between or among, or you are even in the middle of something, whatever be the interjection, whatever be the situation, whatever be the location, whatever be the moment of your life, whether for you, you are like David that says, this situation is like passing through the valley of the shadow of death. He was able to see the amazing hand of God that even though is a testimony of a present continuous consciousness and experience of a person that is still in the middle of a journey. In other words, even though I pass, the word I pass is a first person continuous present. Even though it's a personal testimony and experience. Even though some other people I do not care, may be having an easy-go-lucky life. Some other people I do not care, may have life on a street of gold. Some other people I do not care, may be cruising on his street of America. Some other people I do not care, may press every button and it answers for them. But for me, even though I don't care about you, even though I don't care about them, work, pass, live, because the word pass is a condition of existence. You can exchange it with live. I am living in. It's a passing phase. It's not like a walk. It's not the explanation of David when he said, even though I pass or I walk, it's not talking about a stroll. Is explaining a condition in which he was, which is like a passage of life. My present experience right now is like a walk through hell. My present experience right now may be like a walk through difficulty. I am like a bull that was tied down by the master. Now, what do you say about that? That donkey in Bethphage that was tied down by the master. Nobody ever rode him. Possibly there were days when that bull will feel dejected, will feel rejected, will feel alone. Why is it that of all the donkeys in Jerusalem, why is it that of all the donkeys in Bedford, I am the only one tied down? And when you feel tied down, you will see your mate, your equal, your classmate, your neighbor, your contemporary. You will see them on busy streets where you are tied down. You will see them making waves while you are tied down. You will see them buying cars, cars of your dream. You will see them own beautiful jobs, build or buy beautiful mansions, and then you are tied down. The Bible says, even though I pass through, even though my passage right now, my experience right now, my family life right now, even though my financial situation right now may be like a passage through hell. You remember the song of Ron Kenoly? If you catch hell, don't hold it. And if you're going through hell, what do you do?
Go ahead.
Don't stop. He said, you go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. Don't stop. Go ahead. You go ahead. Sometimes it sounds so easy, and people say talk is cheap. But here in the Word of God, God is trying to teach us something. That whether you feel you are in the middle of an experience, now, the middle, when you translate the word middle, that means there is a passage in which you feel like fire is the situation. When you turn to the right, it is fire. In your finances, it is fire. When you try to escape one, you see so many other circumstances and situations tearing at you that your wisdom cannot cope with. You need God. That you can cry and scream. And sometimes you sob in your secret corner upon your pillow. Your pillow wet. All night long, it's like you are between the fire. Or sometimes you don't feel you are between the fire. You feel like you are in the middle of nowhere. Oh my God, when life takes us on a dark side, when life takes us on a very narrow alley, when life takes us on the bitter side of the story, when our script is not like in the crescendo, when our script is like in the diminuendo. In music, there is something they call crescendo and diminuendo. What that means is when you are singing and the song is going up and everybody is fascinated and in their seats, in the performing hall, you can almost perceive your listener doing like this, as if they are rising with you, as your pitch and tonation rises. Our mighty fortress is our God. And as you rise, you can feel everybody fascinated by the rise of the music, and they are jolted on their seat. And suddenly, as you are rising, our mighty fortress is our God. Bulwark never failing. And then, in the same sense with which they rise with your voice, you see them sink. That is what is called diminuendo in music. So, whether life is on the crescendo, things are on the increase as expected, everything being equal, you know, the economist, they play with that word a lot. But nothing has ever been equal. Nothing is ever equal. They say everything being equal, rain will fall. Everything being equal, you will graduate and get a job. Everything being equal. But life is not always on the easy street. We say life is a bed of roses, but we always forget that roses have thorns. Roses have thorns. So if your life were to be a bedspread of roses, prepare to be pricked when you turn. So now, when you feel that there is fire and you are in the middle, when you feel that you are in the midst, or when you think you are between, you feel your life is sandwiched between circumstances. At work, you are troubled. At home, you are buffeted. Within, there is battle. Without, there is war. Even when you trust yourself sometimes in the hands of brethren, some of them are false brethren. And that is why some people thought that church is all about works, because they think if church were to be a place for truth, then where? Why are there hypocrites in the church? We need more hypocrites in the church. Now, somebody was asking a question. He said, "Pastor, I'm not going to come to church." Why? He said, "Because there are hypocrites." He said, "Yes, there are hypocrites in the church, and we need one more. That's why we're asking you to come." Of course, sometimes when you trust yourself upon believers, you discover that some of them are false brethren, and it hurts like fire. Oh, don't it? It burns like fire when you find out that somebody you trust, somebody you rely upon, is fake. It's like fire. Sometimes you trust your matter in the hand of a fellow believer, always to find yourself in the market square. Your matter has been traduced and reduced all over the place. Everybody's talking about you. They rail at you. They stigmatize you. They isolate you. Wicked things that you cannot even imagine have been published by the day about you. The Bible called that forward mouth of fire. It burns like fire. So that's when you feel you are between fire. Fire of false brethren. And the only reasonable question from the mouth and heart of great majority of us is God. Why? God, why? When you pray by morning or pray by evening or pray anytime, the most popular question on our lips, or sometimes on our heart, or sometimes vibrating on our very sorrowful lips when we are crying, is God. But why? I want us to go ahead and let's read. Mama, please read for us your own version. Verse 2. I am deliberate today in letting us see the beauty of this scripture in different versions. Verse 2, please.
There an angel of the Lord appears to me.
Yes.
From the burning bush. Mm-hmm. Moses saw the bush was on fire, but it was not burning up.
There the angel, read again, please.
There an angel of the Lord appeared to him from a burning bush.
Okay.
Moses saw the bush was on fire, but it was not burning up.
Now, listen. The fire itself was described by this contemporary English. The fire itself was described as the encapsulation of the existence, because it says the angel of the Lord was speaking from the fire. The fire itself is the environmental reality. Do you see how different that is from between, or in the middle, or in the midst? That is It is, the pain is coming from the fire. It means that the experience itself is fire. You don't get that? The experience, something is not, the pain, the heat you are suffering is not coming from between or beside or under or above or in the middle or between fire. The pain itself is coming directly from the fire. The experience is an encounter itself with fire. What happens, gentlemen and ladies, when life, in all its metaphorical sense, appears to be a bunch of fire? What happens? What happens? Some people say, Pastor, Pastor, what is happening to me? Everything about me is wrong. He said, is it only me? It is only me. I have had a sister come to me and say, Pastor, it is only me that we go to school and we find it hard to pass. It is only me that we manage to graduate and I will not receive my results on time. It's either they say it is loss or they delay it sometimes. And when I manage to find a result or find my result, it is only me that will not get a job. When everybody has got a job, it is only me that remain at home. And when I even manage to learn a trade, it is only me that my boss will not like. When I manage to graduate from learning the trade, it is only me that my parents don't have money to give to buy my implement. And when I manage to buy implement, it is only me that people don't even realize I'm doing the business. Nobody ever knocks at my door. He says, my entire life is fire. How does it feel when it's like everything you ever did turn out to be wrong? People you trusted hated you in return. People you love don't well pay you back in the way you feel you deserve. Everything burns like fire. Everything burns like fire. That is when life itself feels like fire. Any other version of the Bible? I want you to see what God is trying to say.
Suddenly, the angel of Jehovah appeared to him as a flame of fire in the bush.
The angel of Jehovah appeared as a flame of fire in the bush. This is a completely different dimension. What happens when you feel that the source of your problem was not your father, was not your mother, was not your own error, was not your boss, was not your friends, was not the situation you find yourself? What happens when you think God himself is inflicting the punishment upon you? The angel of the Lord appeared as the flame of fire. When you feel that, God, but this is not what I bargained. Some of you bargained a very glamorous life. When you were in school, when you were little, when you were small, when you were trying to shape a dream or a future for yourself, and they ask you, what do you want to become? You don't say you want to become a village pastor or a missionary in a far away middle of nowhere. You don't say you want to be a pastor of a small church. No. You don't say you want to be a pastor even with all your beautiful dreams and vision, that you have to depend upon God for every penny, every dime, every provision. No water except God will provide. No food except God will answer. But that was not your vision. That was not my vision. Oh God, oh God, and you think that God is your enemy. God is the one holding you down. That is not strange. You remember the experience of Jeremiah. Jeremiah cried to God. He said, oh Lord, you cheated me because I am weak. You overcome me because you are almighty. You overpower me. And I hate to speak your word, but I cannot keep quiet. I cannot keep quiet because your word is like fire in my bones. What happens when you feel that your experience is because you are obedient to the word of God? What happens? What happens when God tells you to go and preach and then that landed you into trouble and you got fired? And you say, God, why did you set me on fire? That may be your dream job that you just lost. That may be your dream job that you just lost. And you say, God, why? Why am I on this fire? Why? Why am I on this fire? That may be your dream job. When Elisha, a very prosperous businessman, he has herds of flock. He has beautiful farmland with yokes and oxen and servants. The day he met Elijah, that was the day his destiny turned. To the ordinary man, to the man of the flesh, to a perception of carnality, that was the day his entire life dream was set ablaze. Because the day he met Elijah, two things happened to him. God cornered him, and God hijacked his ambition. His ambition, the ambition of Elisha, was to be the most populous, the most prosperous businessman in oxen, in yokes. But when God cornered him, it was like all his entire life dream was set ablaze. Why ask why when God sets the fire? Elisha had no idea on earth what God is capable of making out of his life. But he yielded, he succumbed to the fire. The Bible says he slaughtered all his animals. He broke all the oxen, and he used the yokes to cook the animals and served them to his friends, to his servants, so that there is no going back. You know, when you break, when you cross the Rubicon and it is broken, there is no going back. There's no going back. So now to an ordinary man, God is setting me on fire. But look at something. Look at something. There is something very refreshing to me in this verse 2. Very refreshing. The Bible says, the angel of the Lord spoke from the middle of the fire. That is number one. Number two, the Bible says, behold, the bush burnt with fire, and the bush was not consumed. When God causes our life to go through fire, there is a strategy for survival. God never allows his people to be consumed, no matter the intensity of the fire. And I decree and declare upon your life, over your business and your dreams, no matter the intensity of the fire, whether you feel you are betrayed, or you feel you are among, or you feel that you are in the fire itself, or life in all its entirety, or you think that God and his strategy is nothing but fire, God has a plan by which you are not to be consumed. If I take you on a memory lane, when the choices and the decisions of the three Hebrew brothers, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, hand them a furnace when their choices and their stands for God. Now, we live in the West. We live in America. Some people who listen to us right now around the world live also in the West. Some of them in Germany, some of them in Australia, some of them in England, some of them in places that are very hostile to the gospel. What happens when God's command to you is like a setup? As if God is setting you up for jail. As if God is setting you up for fire. What happens? The experience of Shadrach, of Meshach, and Abednego was like God himself setting them up for fire. The command of God for them is that you must not bow for any other God. You must not worship any other God. You must not worship any other image. You must not bow down. Now, it doesn't have to be Nebuchadnezzar. Listen to me, people of God. It doesn't have to be Nebuchadnezzar. If you are afraid of your boss and you are not able to stand your ground as a believer in Christ Jesus so much that you cannot tell the truth, even if the Spirit of God convinces you that your position needed to be said, and you keep the truth to yourself, you are bowing down for Nebuchadnezzar. If you are working in Walmart, or in Kroger, or in Sam's Club, or in any kind of market, and the Spirit of the Lord prompts you that you must not keep quiet, you see a situation of ungodliness, that you must open your mouth and talk, and you open your eyes, and there are policemen, there are patrolling officers, and you are afraid, and you cannot bear to speak, because you think that may land you in trouble. You are bowing down for Nebuchadnezzar. So that time, you think God is setting you up for fire. When you are in a work situation and your boss comes to your desk and said, "Michael, congratulations, you have been a hard worker." I said, "Thank you very much, sir." I said, "For this reason, the management of this company have chosen and decided to promote you." "Oh, thank you. Congratulations to you." Thank you, sir." And they said to you, "Now, from Friday, you are going to be the managing director. Maybe you are just a storekeeper, or maybe a nobody, or even maybe a general manager." And they said, "You are going to be a managing director of this company, and that will give you a raise from maybe $20 per hour to about $40 per hour times 2, or possibly times 2.5, or possibly times 3, with every benefits to match. And they give you further condition that you are going to be at work every Sunday." And then you think to yourself, "But I pray for this promotion." Can you think that? Some of you will start rationalizing that, okay, I will take the offer and trust God to change their mind. But for a Christian who understands that the devil tempts you with easy escape to prevent you from greater honor, that believer knows that that is a no. That is a no. That is a total no. I remember when I was still in Nigeria, and we struggled a lot. And somebody came to me. My wife is here. My children were very small, many, many years ago. In fact, we only had Anyefe and Ine. Ori hasn't come there. Somebody brought something very beautiful and glamorous to me and presented it to me. It will have straightway hand me dollars, keyed me into quick honor, quick money. But it involves me pretending to be somebody else and changing documents and falsifying something. I told them, I said, "Thank you for the offer. Simon Olatuji will not bear that name, because the name is a foreshadowing of rejection of Christ. I will not. But some Christians will be believing that God will change the mind because we are driven by worship of some substance. Can you understand what I'm saying? Money is not everything. Money is not sin, but the love for it is the root of all evil. If you are tempted by it, you are not wise. Because it's the same circumstance by which fire tried Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. All they needed to do and go scot-free is bow. Is there any big deal? In the foolishness of my people, they will say, let us call a madman uncle so that we can pass. When you see a madman coming with cutlass, you just say, uncle today, uncle, yeah, so that you can pass. But in the kingdom of God, that worldly wisdom has no place. You dare not call the devil your uncle. If you call him your uncle, you are enlisted in his family. Because all the devil needs is a foothold. He doesn't need 2 feet. That's why the Bible was very clear to instruct that do not give the devil a foothold. If you give him a foothold, he will hang the other feet, and that is enough to wreak entire havoc in your entire life, in every corner and department of your life. He will just stand limbo on one leg, and he will destroy your dream, destroy your calling, destroy the blessing of God upon your life, destroy your future, and steal your joy. So that when you are going through fire, God has a plan. When God allows Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to go through their own fire, God was trying not to humiliate them. God was trying to show the entire kingdom of Babel, the entire kingdom of Ahasuerus and Nebuchadnezzar, the entire kingdom of Medes and Persia, and the entire Babylon, that there are some people that fire cannot burn. There are some people that fire, no matter how intense, let them be 10 times hotter. The Bible says, and then Nebuchadnezzar burned with fury. If you read King James Version, he said, with indignation, and he made the fire 10 times hotter. The devil wants to harass you and cause you to be afraid. He will exaggerate the situation before you. And when you are not careful, you bow to Nebuchadnezzar. You ask why. God, why are you bringing this fire my way? People of God, why ask why when you know that God has a plan? Nebuchadnezzar was burning with anger, was demanding repentance and change of mind. He arraigned them before him and said, I give you a count of 10. Change your mind or you are devoured. As he was foaming in his indignation, he commanded his lieutenant. He commanded them to make the fire 10 times hotter, and he gave an alternative. He said, I will give you a second chance. And then he commanded all his musicians, dulcimer, harp, all kinds of music. He said they should play again. And then whilst the sound of the trumpet, dulcimer, all kinds of music are played, a second chance arises. He said, if you bow, then I will smile on you. And then I will enlist you in my kingdom. But if you do not, see, Shadrach, Meshach, look, Abednego, see my left hand. The fire is already 10 times hotter. And then while the king was foaming and he was shaking in his leg and he was shaking and he was corrosive and morose and melanchonizing his eyes, Shadrach said, excuse me, sir. Calm down. Don't give yourself hypertension. We are not careful to answer you. Do you see that? The technicality of that response. In other words, we are not trying to be meticulous. We are not trying to weigh options. What happens when you have that kind of environmental circumstance? You weigh options. You weigh options. You calculate. Okay, the situation in my hand now. You calculate, I was earning $12 per hour. This is going to afford me easy payment of my. Then you strike your mortgage. This will afford me. I can now buy the car of my dream, Toyota Avalon. If some people refuse to dash me, I can now buy me Toyota Avalon.
Color white.
Pastor Kiyemi, you are spiritual. Pastor Ajiboye, you are not laughing very well. I suspect you. You are just not laughing. I just suspect you. Now, and then you begin to rationalize and you are careful. That is the meaning of that scripture. He said, excuse me, Mr. Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer you in this matter. Then look at what happens. Even if our God, wow, we are not ready to ask why God is taking us through this. Even if this fire is caused by God, or if the fire caused by you, God is not ready to deliver us. Still, we will not bow. I want to ask you a quick question, church. When Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were making this assertion, are they aware that God has a plan? Answer me, church.
No.
Let us agree on this matter.
No.
Now, if you are saying yes, raise your hand. If you are saying no, raise your hand. Now, if you are saying no, say I. Okay. The eyes have it. Nobody among them, not even their big brother, Daniel, not even the king himself is aware that anything on earth, no God, he even told them, no God on earth can deliver you from my hand. No God. What happens when you think that the fire you are passing through, God doesn't appear to be able? The bills every month, God doesn't appear to be all that is sufficient for you. The harassment and insult that you receive from your neighborhood, God doesn't appear to care about it. The reproach of your infertility, when you trust God for just one fruit. A woman approached me many, many years ago and said, Pastor, even if it is to get pregnant in the morning and by evening it is aborted, let God try me with one single pregnancy. When you think that that answer is an impossible end or a distant unreality, what do you say to God? Everything was harassing their sense of faith. And they were not aware that God has a plan. People of God, we have the privilege today, because at the day and at the time that Moses saw that fire, he was not aware that God has a plan. The fire that Moses thought, and every curiosity and sensitivity in the heart of Moses in that morning, was the fire fire that the people of Israel were passing through who were in Egypt. They were going through fire because their taskmaster made their bodies heavy. They gave them no straw, yet their daily labor was not diminished. They drove them to make plows and build pythons and realises for Pharaoh. Their back were bent in servitude, and yet they were not rewarded for their labor and pain. So that is all the fire that Moses knew. But God showed his own fire to demonstrate that no matter the fire that the enemy is showing up in your life, I am God that rise on the wind of fire. I am God that I am like the flame of fire myself. Even if you pass through fire, then will not consume you. In case you don't believe that scripture, now you see it. When I say when you pass through fire, it will not burn you. When you pass through water, it will not overpower you. Now you see it. So why do you ask why? We ask why because we are not aware what God is capable of making out of our situation. We ask why when we are blinded by those circumstances and those flame of fire prevent us from seeing the one who rides on the wing of fire. We ask why when we allow the heat, the furnace, the blast noise of the fire to becloud our sense of perception of the Almighty God who says, you will pass through fire and it will not burn you. We ask why when we are not aware that God does have a plan. We ask why when we are not careful to perceive the voice of the fire, that it is the voice of God. We ask why when we are not ready to turn the way Moses said. Moses said, I am going to turn now and behold this sign. Why the fire burns? We ask why when we are not able to turn. People of God, why are you asking the question why? God doesn't answer the question why. Because he is God. He is God. Even on the hill cross of Calvary, when the darkness covered the earth, thick darkness the people, and the burden of sin was looming heavily upon our Lord Jesus, and the clouds became darkened, and God, who could not behold sin, turned his back on his only begotten Son. He said, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, Father, Father, why have you forsaken me? That is the time that the voice should have answered from heaven. Then no voice came. God does not answer the question why. Why ask why? When the shadows cast upon your heart. Why ask why? I want you to bow your heart and bow your head and pray. Ask God to help you. You help the people of old. You help Shadrach and help Meshach and help Abednego. You can help me, Father. Yeah. You can help me, Lord. You can help me to ride upon my wind and my circumstances and the fire, no matter how intense. You can help me to live with my meager income. You can help me to face the reproach of widowhood. You can help me to go through this waiting period of childlessness. You can help me to mark time victoriously and gallantly, eagerly awaiting the glorious manifestation of your promise in my life. You can help me to go through this wilderness experience and come out shining. You can help me to walk through the valley of shadow of death and yet fear no evil. You can help me, even though I pass through water and it shall not haunt me, all over me. You can help me, even if I pass through fire and make it not upon me. You can help me if I lift up my eyes to the hills and find my help come from above. You can help me. Why not cry to God? Ask Him to help you. Ask Him. Ask Him to help you. Ask Him to carry you through the journey. Ask Him to send you through the difficulty. Ask Him. Ask Him. Even if you feel you lack wisdom. Wisdom to deal with your matter. Wisdom to relate with your family issues, family people, your work people. Wisdom to live your life and a righteous life. Wisdom to live victorious in the world. Wisdom to live as a citizen of Zion in Babylon. Wisdom to face the fire. Ask Him. He said, if anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask of me. We are going to sing this song in my life. Father, be glorified. Be glorified today. And I want everybody to please stand up as we sing that song together. Raise up your two hands to the Lord and say it with the whole of your heart. Pour your heart like an offering before the Lord. Pour your heart, the whole of your heart. Pour your heart. In my life, Father, be glorified. Sing it, church.
Scripture inspiration will come in the name of Jesus.
continuous to be with them. That every one of them that will be passing through fire, the God of heaven will give them the grace to endure, so that they will learn the lesson that God is trying to pass through. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Jesus Christ, and for the country of the world, the nation Israel, which is the wash of God on the earth, that the peace of Almighty God will reign in the nation of Israel, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed.
Amen.
We thank God tonight because we have visitors in our midst. And my brother, I know that the Lord has really blessed you tonight. Has the Lord been good to you? Praise the Lord. Can we please extend our hands of affection to Him? Let's extend our hands of lunch hour fellowship. Give you a chance, but on Sunday we want to see you face again. And we are trusting God that whatever may be your heart desire, God Almighty will address it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In closing the service, let's bring that our offering. The scripture says we must not appear before God empty. So therefore, let's bring that our offering. It's important that we come before the Lord. Forever. 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 Forever.